Hello to everyone. I would like to welcome you to the second part of the lecture Physics 1221, Physics 1231. The first part was given by Tim Duty, as you are certainly aware of. Second part is me. My name is Clemens Ulrich. The second part will be about optics, wave optics, starting from Maxwell equations, and the second part of the lecture, Introduction into Quantum Mechanics. Up front, a few technical details. As you all are aware of, we are now moving to online teaching. Idea is we record it on tape, like today, and then upload it on Moodle. However, face-to-face meetings are also very important to me. So my offer to you is send me an email. My email address is given here. And then I will arrange a Zoom meeting with you directly through email contact. So in addition, handwritten lecture notes about the entire lecture are already uploaded on Moodle. Please feel free to look at them. I'll try to provide you also with an electronic version, but it's the moment quite intense for all of us. So, but if you have any technical problems here, please feel free to contact me also directly by email, and I'll try to provide you with a proper solution. Important question is, certainly, will there be exams? Yes, we are working on that. Actually, the exam paper is drafted, and the university is at the moment looking for solutions how the exam will then be in the end conducted. So, simply spoken, yes, everything is well on track. So, before I really start with the lecture, I would like to show you some pictures of some of the most important people, names which you had heard before. Ampère, French scientist from Lyon. He was actually starting his career in the difficult times of the French Revolution, and his father even got executed because he didn't follow the new regime. So in these difficult times, he performed these outstanding, important experiments where actually the entire Ampère's rules, current, Coulomb law, and so on are based on. Another important name, Alessandro Volta from Italy. And last but not least, James Maxwell from the UK, Edinburgh. And I would like to show you in a few minutes his first and most important publication, which was really the starting point for our known electrodynamics. So, Charles Coulomb, very interesting person. He actually was born in an royal family, which was a very difficult time during the French Revolution. Before the Revolution, he was already captain in the army because he was also such an ingenious engineer. He was dismissed from army and his family was mostly in jail during the French Revolution. But soon after, the army hired him again because they didn't know that he is such an ingenious engineer. They really needed him. They did send him to Martinique, a nice island, and his job there was to build the military seaport. And at the weekend, simply spoken, instead of going to the beach, he did build all these fantastic devices, which you can see here, for example, on that slide, in his own spare time and from his own private money. And he discovered such important rules like Coulomb law. After his military service, he immediately became a member of the French Academy of Science. So a real ingenious person. So, optics. What we are gonna discuss in the next couple of lectures is actually, what is light? What's the nature of light? And up front, can already tell you that why light has actually two fundamental properties. It behaves like an electromagnetic wave on one side. And in the second part of the lecture, you will hear from me that light also has particle properties. In the end, we will call that wave-particle dualism. But let's start with the wave properties of light. Light is an electromagnetic wave. And here you see the color spectrum of light. The visible light, as we know it, covers just a tiny section of the entire spectrum of electromagnetic radiation. In wavelength terms, it's something like 380 nanometers to 750 nanometers. 1 nanometer is 10 to the power of minus 9 meters. And in the entire range here, you see that the light spectrum, visible light spectrum, is just a tiny section. In terms of wavelength, light can go from meters or kilometers wavelength down to femtometers and lower. Energy of light is inverse to that, so the lower the wavelength, the higher the energy of radiation. And that's actually clear, I think you all are aware of that. If we go lower than 380 nanometers, we enter ultraviolet light. Ultraviolet light is extremely high energies, and you all know that if you go to the beach, you get a sunburn, basically because of the UV radiation. Let's now have a look at the entire light spectrum. So radio frequencies are actually in the range from a couple of centimeters to a couple of hundred meters. The normal radio in our days, FM, is in the range of a couple of centimeters, but the long range AM radio frequencies are a couple of hundreds of meters, and that's also a reason why you can broadcast AM radio over really long distances, over thousands of kilometers, whereas FM radio is just relatively short distances. Radio waves are in the same range. If you go a little bit shorter, centimeter range, that's the typical range for radar frequencies, like at an airport. Next, infrared radiation. Infrared radiation is mostly known as thermal heat. So with infrared radiation, a surface can heat up. Visible range of light, as discussed, a very short section of this entire spectrum. Above that, in energies, ultraviolet and then X-ray. X-ray radiation, for example, known in hospitals. Here the wavelength range is typically around 1 or 0.1 nanometers. And at very high energies or very low frequencies, gamma ray starts. Gamma ray is also known as one source of radioactive radiation, ionizing radiation. This can really cause damages in the molecules of a body, which could result in cancer. So gamma ray is dangerous. If you now go out into the universe, there might be even higher energy gamma radiation. Luckily here on Earth, we are largely protected by that from our atmosphere. A rainbow nicely spreads the light spectrum into all the different colors. And here I have a pretty interesting rainbow, I would call it. That's actually me standing on top of a mountain in Bavaria, Germany. And the rainbow here is almost 360 degree. And in the center, you actually can roughly see me standing there. The rainbow is actually twofold. There are two color schemes, as you see. But the rainbow nicely splits the light spectrum into its independent colors. You see here, it goes from red over yellow, green, and dark blue. Throughout the lecture, we will discuss other methods, how you can actually split up the spectrum of light into its own individual colors. This is the light spectrum of the sun. And in addition, underneath its color code, this is what you can measure here on Earth. In principle, the color spectrum is black body radiation, which would be a nice smooth curve, the Planck's radiation spectrum. That was actually also the foundation of modern quantum mechanics, the explanation of that. That's coming later. The color spectrum of light goes from hard UV, dark blue, green, yellow, red, and finally infrared. The Planck radiation spectrum would be a smooth curve. In addition, you see some peaks here cutting into the spectrum, and these are the spectral lines of individual atoms, the atomic transitions inside an atom. And in the bar on the lower side, you see the hydrogen, sodium, magnesium lines, for example. So that's the color spectrum emitted from the sun. A side note here, you might realize that the maximum of sun intensity is around 550 nanometers, nicely in the green. And that's a simple reason why plants or flowers and trees, why the leaves are in green color, that's optimized to the maximum of the emission spectrum to the sun. Light. What is light? French scientist Fizeau performed an experiment in 1849 where he was able to measure the speed of light. Actually, he used a strong light source, a candle, strong candle with a reflecting mirror on the back to enhance the signal, and in 8 kilometers distance, a second reflecting mirror. He aligned it that way that the light beam is perfectly reflected. He had a spinning chopper wheel, and he then with slits in it, and he then accelerated this spinning chopper wheel to such a speed that the reflected light got blocked. So this the chopper wheel started to move on, and when the light got reflected, traveling distance two times 8 kilometers, that when it returned, it got totally blocked. And from that geometry, he actually calculated the speed of light, and his result was 313,000 kilometers per second, which is pretty close to what we know in our days. The different speeds of light determined theoretically and in experiment are actually given in the table here. And today we know that the speed of light is 299,796 kilometers per second. I would like to show you the original publication, not in full length, but a few sections out of the original publication here of Maxwell. This was published, as you see, in March 1861. It's in total a 71-page document. I have it on my computer here. It's a really remarkable publication. It's really outstanding. In here, it's just a section in the middle out of that publication. These are actually the mathematical expressions which he used. And if you look at that, you realize that it's basically the same maths, the same equations, the same differential equations which we use in our days. So everything was established already at that time when Maxwell wrote his paper. So, in the introduction, Maxwell actually wrote that at the moment there's not much known about the nature of electricity and about light. So here, I put it here in red color. The nature of electricity, whether it's one substance, two substances, or not a substance at all, or in what way it differs from matter, and how it's connected with it, is simply not known. Why we still have doubts on that. So that was his starting point. That was the current wisdom in 1861. Then he derived all the equations which we are now know as the Maxwell equations, and in the end, the wave equation of light. And he concluded in the end that the wave equation of electromagnetic radiation is connected with the square root of the magnetic susceptibility. And from the measured value at that time, he actually got a speed of 310,740 meters per second. He compared it with the measured speed of light from the Fizeau experiment, and from that he concluded that this is basically the speed of light. Electromagnetic radiation is nothing else than light. So here in red, what he wrote by himself, light consists in the transverse modulation of the same medium, which is the cause of electric and magnetic phenomena. I found that publication as absolutely outstanding. As said, he started that at the moment the nature of electricity is not known, and 70 pages later here he had derived all equations which describe the electrodynamics which we know in our days, and concluded that light is an electromagnetic wave. So this is really remarkable. Just to conclude this first part of the lecture of today, here a nice picture of a comet where you actually see the scattering of light from the sun nicely. And I will come back to that picture in a future section. So, thank you very much. This was the first part of the lecture today. Further parts will follow soon.